while central banks are very influential in the short term, in the long term, they're kind of they're captured by this process. And at some point, if we had a crisis where central banks intervened and that still wasn't enough, then you risk a real meltdown.
Thanks for joining for another episode of The Empire's New Clothes. I'm your host, Brad from MacArthur. In case you're new, what we do here is we look at the forces that make and break empires. And that brings us to our guest today, Kevin Coldiron. He co-founded a hedge fund. He teaches financial engineering at Berkeley Haas Business School. And he co-authored a book called The Rise of Carry. And that's what we're going to look at today. Many have asked, do central banks control markets? Kevin and his colleagues have actually answered that question, and their conclusion might surprise you. Kevin, thanks so much for being here. Really looking forward to this conversation today.
Thanks, Bradford. It's my pleasure to join you.
Of course. So we're going to dive into some complex financial mechanics, but hopefully explain them in a very approachable and easy to comprehend way. And to kind of kick that off, I read an article you wrote about your teenage son who got into day trading. And so before we even start, I just want to know that process of your son kind of heading in a similar direction to you, but slightly different. You know, I don't know if he's doing YOLO call options or anything, but what have you learned or perceived markets behaviors differently given that experience?
That's a interesting question. Yeah, it's been an interesting experience for me to watch him, because the markets are kind of like a window into the wider world. And so by looking at stocks and trying to decide what to buy and sell, he's kind of engaging with the themes that are going on in the world. You know, the electric car revolution, and, you know, what's happening with the opening up with after the coronavirus, et cetera. So, I think what's really come home to me is the accessibility and ease of trading relative to when I was a kid. You know, I mean, I know you're in Canada. I remember my dad buying some Canadian mining stock, and we had to wait once a week for the Sunday newspaper to come to see what the price was, you know, and there was no, thought of selling. Whereas, you know, my son, I think I said in the article in 2021 or something, did like 280 trades. They don't cost anything. You can trade in small size. So, you know, if a 17-year-old kid can kind of educate himself and do that, then it's not surprising to me that we're seeing this huge expansion of retail trading volume. That said, and I want to do like a one-year update on him in a couple of months, but I do suspect that his interest is, I wouldn't say waned exactly, but the volume of his trading, I think, has definitely gone down. And I think part of that is because, you know, we've opened up, he's back at school, him and his friends have got other stuff to do. So I do think there was an element of, you know, the trading stocks was a distraction, but not totally. I mean, he's still into it. He still comes into my room and has ideas and things like that. I don't get the sense he's churning the portfolio the way he was this time last year.
Interesting. Did you get your start kind of by proxy through your father as well, or just
Actually, it was more my grandfather was a butcher in New York City and did quite well and started to get interested in the stock market. And so when I was a young kid, he, you know, gave me shares in General Public Utility, GPU. And, you know, that was a window into the world, right? I like wait for the newspaper, watch the stock price, figure out what all that meant. And then we started subscribing to Value Line, which was this old school service where they would send you a kind of a binder with valuations of all these companies, and they had their own ranking system and things like that. So, it was really through my grandfather, who was a kind of a personal investor, that I got interested. And then I had a high school teacher who was also super into it. And
cool.
He kind of encouraged me from there.
That's pretty cool. You know, I actually of a its great grandfather. Apparently, he shorted the market in 29, made a whack load of money. And then him and his partner, his partner then burnt through it all. Or I don't know the story. It's a family story I want to dive down into someday. That money definitely doesn't exist anymore. But it's very interesting thinking about markets, especially just like in a family, because at the end of the day, you might be using different indicators and different processes and frameworks, but it's still a price. There's a buyer, a seller, and then they come together and make a market. So it's really this thing's been going on for a long, long time. People come in together and trading goods.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's kind of like fundamental to human society. No question about it.
It is.
And, you know, we'll get into this in our conversation, but, you know, in our book, we talk about this idea of carry and you know, mm-hmm. some of the negative consequences that have come about through its growth. But one thing I'm always keen to point out is we're, you know, a certain amount of trading, a certain amount of liquidity is important and useful for our economy. So the ability to buy a share in a company, to provide them capital, to provide liquidity to someone who wants to sell, that's a really valuable thing. So I don't want anyone to come away from this conversation thinking that I'm against that mm-hmm. in any way. I'm not. But when there's sometimes too much of a good thing is also a problem, right? When there's too much liquidity, when it's too easy to trade, that encourages people to think of holding shares like a bank account, right? I can always access that money. When it's not, it's much riskier. And we'll get into those ideas in a second, but I'm very much in favor of, you know, of the capitalist system. I just think it's gone in a direction that needs to be kind of redirected a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I hear you. I'm hearing moderation in this idea of being a bit more balanced. And too much of a good thing, I think of November 1st as a kid after binging all night on Halloween candy. Like we all know what that feels like. So let's look at this idea. So your book, The Rise of Carry, you co-authored. Let's unpack that. What is this idea of carry? Some people are going to understand this, but maybe we can break this down a little bit.
Yeah. So we talk about carry at its basic level as a trade or a transaction that makes money if nothing happens, right? Which sounds a little strange, but when you think about it, it's... our definition would be basically borrowing money, paying for that money, paying an interest rate, and then using those borrowed funds to invest in something that generates a higher yield, right? So let's think of, you know, you're in Canada, the buy-to-let property market is big there, right? So if you can borrow at 2% and you can buy a condo in Vancouver or Toronto and you can earn... 5% from renting it out. So you're taking in 5% and you're paying out 2%. That's a carry trade. And it makes money if nothing happens, in the sense that as long as the world stays the same, as long as you're able to rent out your apartment, as long as the price of the apartment building, the condo, doesn't change, you're going to earn that at little 3% spread. The difficulty is that it's also a fragile trade, right? When things do change, when, for instance, coronavirus happens and you're no longer able to rent out your apartment, now your income is zero, but your interest payments are 2%, you've got a problem. And if that's happening at the same time that other people are having the same problem, then the value, the price of that condominium is going to go down. And so if you need to sell it, you could be in a situation where having to sell below the value of what you bought. And it gets a little worse because the people who lent you the money are nervously watching the value of condos thinking, hey, he might not be able to pay me back. So in the financial markets, they can actually mm-hmm. force you to sell your condominium. And so if everyone's being forced to sell their condominiums or whatever at the same time, then the price gets pushed down in a kind of a vicious spiral. So at a simple level, carry trade is just borrowing money, paying in at low interest rate and investing at a higher rate. So it always involves borrowed money. And it's as long as the world stays the same, it's profitable. when the world becomes more volatile, when things change, that's when those trades can go wrong. That's why we talk about this notion of volatility suppression, which is a fancy term. It just means the more people who are doing carry trades, the more fragile the world is, and the more the, if you will, the authorities have an interest in keeping volatility low and stopping this kind of vicious spiral from happening.
And so what, let's extrapolate this.
Yep.
And how come this is relevant today? Because I hear the examples, but maybe someone's not not doing that with condos. It seems like, you know, reading your book, it seems like a lot of people are involved in this carry trade. In fact, perhaps most of the market. So maybe connect those dots. How is this a bigger force?
Yeah. So the book is called The Rise of Carry, and rise being the key word there, because what we claim is that if we rolled the clock back to, let's say, 1987, that carry trades have always been around, right? You could think of banking as a form of carry trade, right? The bank borrows your money. When you make a deposit, the bank borrows your money. It doesn't pay you very much on that, but it pays you something, and then reinvests that money, loans it out, and earns a higher interest rate. That's a carry trade, right? The bank is paying you a low rate on its borrowed money and investing it at a higher rate. And that's a good thing in the sense that it creates liquidity, it provides source of capital for businesses, et cetera. So carry trades were not unknown, but in the financial markets, it was a relatively small piece, mainly confined to the currency markets, right? So currency markets are an easy place to play carry trades because interest rates are so, you know, it's easy to see them and it's easy to trade. So a classic carry trade in the 1980s would have involved like European currencies, where there were quite big differences in interest rates between, say, the German mark and the Italian lira. So you could borrow German marks, maybe pay a couple of percent, invest in Italian lira, earn 9, 10, 11%. And as long as there's no change in the exchange rate, then that's a very profitable trade. So in the 1980s, we had carry trades going on, but confined to a small corner of the market. Gradually over time, carry trades have expanded and to include kind of all areas of the financial markets. And we would argue it's kind of like the dominant form of trade right now. So we talk about, you know, buy to let properties. So it's not just Canada that's a big deal. It's a big deal in the UK, the US, China. We talk about private equity transactions as basically being carry trades, where private equity firms borrow money and they invest in an underlying firm that earns profits that are higher than what they're paying on the borrowed money. That's a carry trade. There's a whole range of kind of complicated derivative transactions that are basically carry trades. Anytime you sell an option, if you sell a put option or a call option, you're taking in some money in terms of premium, what you get for selling the option, and you're taking on a contingent liability. So potentially you're going to have to pay out much more than what you've taken in from selling the option if the price of the stock goes up or down. And that's also a carry trade. So the world in the book, we kind of trace the world's evolution from a situation where we had carry and it was operating as a good thing to provide liquidity to the markets, to now where it's grown in size so much that, you know, the world has become excessively fragile.
The thing for me that really stood out in learning and reading about this is that the common narrative today is central banks control the markets. Whereas looking at it through the eyes of the rise of carry, it looks like markets are completely controlling central banks. So can you dive into that relationship a little bit there? Because I think most people today are like, yeah, no, central banks control the markets. Markets are dead. It has everything to do with Jay Powell and his buds. But it's almost the opposite from your perspective.
It is. And we talk about this quite early on in the book. We say, hey, look, why do the markets kind of hang on every utterance of central bankers like it's the word of God? And we talk about this kind of paradox, and the paradox being that on the one hand, central bankers seem all powerful, and in some sense in the short term they are, but in the long term they actually they're being controlled by carry. Like, they actually have very little power. So if to understand that, let's think about what happens when a financial market carry trade goes wrong, right? There was a firm in 1998, I'm sure a lot of your listeners would be familiar with, called Long-Term Capital Management, right? So these were the smartest guys in the financial markets, a couple Nobel Prize winners from academia, a couple of very well-known traders from Solomon Brothers, and they formed this hedge fund. And, you know, basically the hedge fund was doing a whole variety of different carry trades. That was their business. So we remember carry trades work when the world stays the same. When the world changes, they can come unstuck. So the world was fairly stable in the mid to late 1990s, but then in 1997, there was a big depreciation in several Asian currencies, which then led to problems in Russia. And a lot of the carry trades that long-term capital had put on started to lose money, and they started to lose money very fast. And the concern was that in being forced to liquidate those trades, long-term capital would have this kind of fire sale effect where it caused markets to crash overall. So central banks, they didn't actually intervene directly to save long-term capital, but they kind of called everyone together in a room in New York City and says, like, hey, you guys need to take over their positions. Basically, a kind of a coerced the market into doing a private sector bailout. And so what happened is, instead of there being a kind of a fire sale effect and long-term capital being completely wiped out, well, long-term capital did get wiped out, but instead of, you know, other people who during the same trades losing money, there was a floor put on those prices.
Kind of contained it.
Contained it, exactly. And so the lesson that the market took from that was, hey,
this is awesome.
These trades aren't as risky as, you know, the so-called, what people talk about, the left tail, the really worst case scenario, did not materialize. So that encouraged people to do carry trades in bigger scale the next time. So when we had a crash in 2008, the scale of carry trades was so great that central banks then had no choice but to intervene and buy assets directly. And when they did that, then again, they put a floor under prices. People who should have been wiped out weren't wiped out. The lesson the market took was, there's a, you know, a put, right? That used to be called the Greenspan put, now the Powell put, basically means that the central banks are providing insurance. And that, you know, encouraged another round, another growing scale of carry trades, which meant that the 2020 intervention had to be even greater in scale than 2008. And when I say greater in scale, I mean that, you know, they basically said, hey, we're willing to buy junk bonds. We'll buy corporate bonds, we'll buy junk bonds. And I actually wrote an article in Forbes. I think the next time around, they'll be kind of in a position where they're forced to buy equities. So central banks, because carry trades create fragility, right? When volatility increases, carry trades come unwound, markets become fragile, central banks are, if you will, forced to intervene, or they feel forced to intervene. The process of that intervention then encourages people to do carry trades again in bigger scale, because they know there's a floor there, which in turn requires bigger intervention, and you have this kind of ratchet process. So our thesis is that, you know, while central banks are very influential in the short term, in the long term, they're captured by this process. And at some point, if we had a crisis where central banks intervened and that still wasn't enough, then you risk a real meltdown. And I'm not trying to scare anyone. I'm just, that's just kind of our view of how we've got here. So it's not like central banks have set out to say we want to control the market. They really don't want to be controlling the market, but they found themselves in this situation, I think, because they haven't each time sat back and say, what are the second order effects of our actions?
It's, you know, everyone loves a good hedge fund blow up story, and that's where this story kind of began. I would go out on a limb and say it's not, well, for one, it's not central banks' fault we're here today. It's not long-term capital either. It seems to be just something with humans, with us. We tend to want to push things and see how far they can go. And it's almost like there were so many safety guards put up and it's just been building and building and building. And it makes me think to that analogy, I've used it, of we've been suppressing wildfires for so long, we're finally going to have a rager. But I'd go one step further and say it's a little bit different. It's almost like there's people running around trying to light fires and, or at least play with matches in dry woods, maybe not purposely try to light fires. And we've been suppressing for so long, but then more and more of these like fire starters are out there. And because there's almost this other dynamic, it's not passive. There's these, the market wants to, in some ways, enact that volatility. That volatility is there and it will rise at some point. And we'll probably get into where does this end up? Like, what is the end game? But I'd actually like to, I really want to know, when did you start connecting these dots? How long ago, when did you start seeing this? Was there an aha moment?
Well, the book is co-authored with Tim Lee, who's an economist, and Jamie Lee, who's actually Tim's son, who's a volatility trader. And so I've known Tim for a long time, and really he's the guy who started pointing out the importance of carry trades to financial markets before the GFC. So he was talking about this in the mid-2000s, and it really, I think, became apparent to Tim in looking at what was going on with Japan, because if you remember, Japan had this great bubble that burst, and then they went through, you know, a process of pushing interest rates very low and quantitative easing. So for a long time, Japan had, you know, ultra low interest rates, while the rest of the world had quite normal interest rates. So people were using Japan as a so-called funding currency for carry trades. In other words, you could borrow in yen at essentially zero and invest in other currencies. And so what Tim was starting to notice was that we'd have a, you know, some type of market event where volatility would rise, and all of a sudden there would be a huge spike, a huge rise in the Japanese yen that was kind of like totally disconnected with market fundamentals. And what was happening was these carry trades where you borrow in yen and, let's say, buy Turkish lira, if that starts going wrong, then you have to sell your Turkish lira and bring the money back to Japan. You have to pay back your lender. And so you would have an event, and all of a sudden these carry trades would unwind and the yen is spiking by, you know, 5-10% for, you know, no apparent reason. So Tim starts looking into that and realized that this carry trade activity was kind of growing in a way that very few people had understood. So I was a client. I ran a hedge fund for a long time, and Tim was we subscribed to his analysis. And so that's how I started to understand. And then he just kept writing about it, and he kept talking about how carry trades are influential. So when I sold my business in 2014, I called him and said, "Hey, I really think, you know, this, we should write a book about this." And he goes, "Well, it turns out I've actually been talking to my son, and we've kind of got an outline for a book, and, you know, they invited me to join them in the project." So we started working on it in 2015. It took us 5 years to put it together. So we've been thinking about this stuff for over a decade now.
And so why write a book? Why not build a different hedge fund based around this core concept?
Well,
or perhaps that's an idea you're working on too. I don't know, but
no, I'm not. Although there are people who, try to, if you will, sort of take the other side of it. The tricky thing is, if you think about, this is actually an important part of why carry has grown, right? So if you were involved in a carry trade, remember I said it makes money as long as nothing happens. So if we go back to our condominium analogy, you're collecting your rent every month, right? And you're collecting more than you're paying out. So month after month, year after year, you've got money coming in and you like that. And then once in a while, once every 5 years, once every 10 years, you have one of these blowups and you lose money. Now, if you think about a financial trader, you think about their time horizon, right? Typically, they're getting paid bonuses that are, you know, yearly, sometimes quarterly. They get a percent of their profits. So, you know, a trade that brings in consistent money is very attractive to them. Yeah, there's going to be a blow up every couple of years, but when you're blowing up, everyone else is blowing up. So you can kind of blame it on the market, and you don't have to give back the bonuses or the profits that you made from those previous years, right? So you can see why people gravitate toward being long carry. Now, if you wanted to take the other side of it, then you need to be prepared for months or years of losing money, and occasionally once in a while you get a big, you know, get a big paycheck. So there's been some very famous people, Nassim Taleb, who wrote The Black Swan, had a fund for a long time where he tried to do that, and he may still be doing that, I'm not sure. It's just tricky because people are impatient, and they don't like that profile of losing money every month, every year for a long time in return for an occasional big payout. Which is, you think about that, this is actually quite important. What does that payout structure look like where you're paying out a little bit every month or a little bit every year in return for once in a while getting a big check coming in? That looks like being long insurance, right? If you know, have insurance on your house, you pay premiums every month, and then if it burns down, then they give you the money to build it back. So carry trades are very similar to selling insurance, and taking the other side is very similar to buying insurance. But what central banks are doing is providing the insurance for us, right? So they are the ones stepping in and giving market participants the insurance, and therefore people don't feel the need to to do it themselves. Yeah. You see what I'm saying?
This really gets to that idea of, I really appreciate in your book how you begin to merge finance and money with power. And even just now, you're talking about there's these flows, like money is flowing from one hand to another hand, from one party to another party. And in some ways, that can be seen as power. But you, in the book, you go even deeper and you talk about this thing, cumulative advantage. So can we break down that a little bit? And then also, you draw some fascinating connections between cumulative advantage, this to inequality.
Right.
And these social divides and currents are feeling today. Can you break some of that down for us?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So let's think about this process again of, I'm a carry trader, and you know, to talk about what we just talked about, I'm making money most of the time, and once in a while there's a blow up, okay? But when the blow up happens, central banks are so worried that it's going to create a crisis that they step in.
This is a wonderful backstop.
Yeah. So what happens? I as a carry trader, I may lose money, but I don't get wiped out. Okay. And then I'm able to, you know, I don't have to return my bonuses from previous years, etc. So who are the people executing carry trades? They tend to be wealthier or more connected. And so this process of, you know, the central banks providing insurance and stopping losses makes carry traders wealthier than they otherwise would be. And they're already people who are at the upper end of the wealth distribution. So unintentionally, this process reinforces and accelerates wealth inequality, right? Some people who should have been wiped out aren't wiped out, and they're, you know, people who should have lost money don't lose as much money as they quote unquote should have. And we get this process of kind of wealth inequality being reinforced. The link to cumulative advantage goes to, you know, who happens to be in a position to do the carry trade in the first place, right? Mm-hmm. It could be, you know, that you happen to go to, you know, a good school and you get a job at a bank and you're introduced to it. So some small, basically small advantage that puts you in a position to, you know, to execute these carry trades, then over time gets reinforced into a much greater advantage. So we try to draw the link between this and just kind of, you know, power in society. And you know, we have some interesting examples where we talk about these Columbia music experiments, you know, where there's two groups of people given the same list of kind of pop songs, and each group is asked to rank those songs from best to worst. And one group gets nothing but the songs, okay, and they produce a ranking, and the ranking is somewhat correlated to how popular the songs actually were. The second group gets the songs and also gets some information as to how popular the songs were in practice, and the rankings they produce is much more correlated to how many albums this music sold. So in other words, a little bit of advantage. In other words, for whatever reason, if a song does well when it starts, that tends to get reinforced. It might not be a better song or a better piece of music, but any initial advantage in our society gets reinforced over time. And so in economic terms, if you're able to be in a situation to exploit carry in a world where central banks are underwriting it, then that advantage is going to get reinforced over the last, you know, three or four decades. You're going to be wealthier and you're going to have a lot more power.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, you highlight these things in the book, and then when you release the book, did you align yourself with any type of cumulative advantage to get boost those sales?
Well, I mean, that's, you know, that's why we've got Instagram influencers, right?
Yeah.
It is. And I think we actually mention them in the book that, you know, if you can get someone, you know, someone's got a whatever 100,000 followers and they mention the rise of carry, you're going to sell a lot more books. Unfortunately, we didn't have a lot of people Instagramming our our book, but I definitely appreciate now, having gone through the process of trying to promote the book, how, yeah, you know, if you, that's why these media outlets like the Financial Times and Bloomberg are so influential, right? Because they reach such a wide audience. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if our book had happened to be mentioned in, you know, one of those, then, you know, sales could spike overnight. And we definitely see that when we do podcasts and things like that.
Well, we'll send you a couple, you know, 200,000-300,000 purchases here after this one.
That would be great.
What can folks do about this if they understand this idea of cumulative advantage, which I think we all feel?
Right.
We subconsciously, we feel that in middle school, high school, you feel these things. It's human nature. And if we look at our society today, it's very stratified in one sense. Is there anything people can do with this information of understanding these power dynamics?
Well, we do live in a democracy, right? We are, you know, the rules that govern our society, they're not set in stone. We can change them. And I think as the as people have started to appreciate, you know, it's funny. So toward the end of the book, we talk about, you know, this notion of how carry has reinforced wealth inequality. And, you know, we talked about how that, you know, is going to become a really big topic for political discussion. I actually thought that was a controversial statement when we were kind of writing the first version of the
book. Ooh, I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Should we mention wealth inequality? You know, and you know, of course, by the time we went from rough draft to getting it published, you know, it's in the political discussion all the time. I mean, Elizabeth Warren ran on a platform of, you know, kind mm-hmm. of a wealth tax. So, you know, it I think it's starting to happen, and it's really a function of, you know, what, to me, if we go back to this talk, what we've talked about, how central banks are providing insurance to the market, right, by intervening to stop market crashes, that reinforces carry trades, reinforces wealth inequality. So that's a form of insurance, but it's like trickle down insurance. It's like, okay, let's stop the bond market from crashing, and that will make everyone better off. I actually think, you know, we need to, if we're deciding that we want to provide insurance, let's do it in a much more direct and effective way. So instead of insuring the big banks and then hoping that doesn't stop, you know, that prevents a general market crash, what are we trying to insure? Well, what we're trying to insure is that ultimately people don't lose their jobs, that their income isn't affected. So I would like to see us move to a world where, and I know Canada is different than the U.S., but where we have some sort of universal basic income, we have better universal health care, we have a floor under living standards. So when, you know, markets get themselves in these, you know, situations, which you've said is always going to happen, we don't have to worry about intervening, because, you know, our citizens are going to be able to navigate it and still maintain kind of, you know, a decent and civilized standard of living. We don't have to, you know, markets don't have to have a gun to our head and say, look, you need to bail us out or really bad things are going to happen. So I've kind of got this pet theory that you can sort of measure how advanced a society is by looking at the risks it deems worthy of insuring, right? And if you look 100 years ago, we didn't have, in the U.S., we didn't have Social Security. There was no unemployment insurance. So we've gradually over time said, yeah, you know, people need some insurance against losing their jobs. They need some insurance against maybe not having saved as much money as they should when they retire. And I think we're heading to a world to say, hey, yeah, we're rich enough that everyone should have a certain amount of money coming in every month. Everyone has right to health insurance. So I'm kind of rambling a little bit, but I do feel like, you know, what central banks are doing is providing a very inefficient form of insurance. I'd like to make that more efficient and then get central banks out of the business of bailing out markets. Maybe that's a pipe dream. Maybe we've come too far. I don't know. But I don't think it's out of the question.
Yeah, no, that's a very interesting point. And it's funny, you're uncomfortable wading into wealth, income inequality in your book. And I get uncomfortable wading into politics sometimes on this show.
Right.
But I think it's very interesting you bring that up, because what I hear you saying is the central bank, or de facto the government in one sense, is providing a floor for a certain group of people, for these people who had that cumulative advantage and they are the carry traders. And you're kind of just saying, I want to see that floor under everybody, this kind of insurance.
Yeah.
Am I oversimplifying that, or?
Yeah, exactly. But I'd like the floor to be, I think that's right. I don't think, you know, to be fair to central banks, someone had to act, right? And so they acted, because they have scope to act quickly. But now we've kind of learned from that experience. We've got a couple decades of it. Let's provide a basic form of floor across society, and not provide this much higher floor to people who are already in an advantage position. Yeah, I absolutely agree with that.
There was this line I read.
It's kind of a weird, sorry to interrupt, Bradford, but it's this kind of like strange mix between kind of free markets and progressivism. Like, on the one sense, I feel like, if you have, you know, enough progressivism and well thought through insurance, then we can step back and allow markets to operate more freely, which in some sense is like, I feel like a bit of a win-win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really interesting philosophical question, because folks, there's a lot of passion on all sides of this, of we shouldn't have more government, we should have less government. Well, right now things aren't firing as they should be. And so I'm not sure what the way forward is. I think maybe we can move into that though and look at this system of carry, which you've really clearly laid out for us that we're operating under. It, I'm sure, is going to keep lasting for a period of time. We have no idea when this might end, but it seems like it's unsustainable. At some point, the system has to change. So maybe help walk me through a little bit of what might that look like? What might come next? How does this thing unravel? And again, it's not a doomsday thing. It's just, it's got to end at some point.
Yeah. Well, it could, in the book, I think we talk about how ultimately it will end with higher levels of inflation, which will require, ultimately will require higher interest rates. And if we get higher interest rates, then carry trades start becoming much more difficult to execute, right? When you can borrow at zero invest even at a couple of percent, that's profitable. But if you're having to pay 5-7% to borrow money, then it's a much riskier prospect to do a carry trade, because the amount of money you're having to pay out every month to fund the trade is much higher, so your margin for error is much smaller. And carry, if you think about it, I've always talked about carry trades as basically a form of borrowing. You're borrowing money at a low interest rate, investing at a higher interest rate. So as carry evolves, the level of debt across the global economy has increased dramatically. So that's a feature of what we call the carry regime, is growing levels of debt. And how do we get out of that debt trap? Well, the classic way is ultimately inflation, right? So you're able to pay the debt back with money that's worth less. And so we expect that that longer term we're entering a period of higher inflation. I think that's starting right now. I'm not saying it's going to be 70 style 15%, but I do think the era of 2% a year inflation is over for now. We're looking more like 3, 4, 5, and potentially beyond that. So now I've forgotten what your original question was. Like, how do we?
No, that's right. What I want to ask is, why must there be inflation? I understand the debt component of, say, I have $100 of debt right now, and in 10 years, $100 buys me a sandwich. So it's very easy to pay off that debt. But why must there be inflation as a signal that the carry regime is ending?
So if we think about what central banks have done, they've basically, each time they intervene, they are... some people call it printing money. I don't particularly like that term, but they are vastly increasing the supply of liquidity. That should, I mean, the laws of supply and demand should be, hold at some level. So the value of the currency, long term, is in danger when we're creating so much of it all the time, and I think it's important. We don't go into this as much as maybe we should have in the book, but if we think about the structural forces over the last 30 or 40 years. So another way to kind of view the carry regime is to say, hey, look, we've had some things going on that have kept downward pressure on prices for 30 or 40 years. China has been integrated into the global economy. In the 1980s, China was not part of the global economy. And in the last three decades, it has. So you've had this massive increase in the supply of labor. And then the Soviet Union broke up. So you had a huge increase in basically low-cost labor. And that low-cost labor was tied in to the global economy. So if I was manufacturing something in the U.S., all of a sudden I could do it cheaper. So that's a steady, important, and very strong deflationary force. The second thing is that the demographics of the global economy have been very favorable, right? Women in the Western world, the so-called advanced economies, their participation rates rose. There was a kind of what's called a demographic dividend where the baby boomers kind of moved into the workforce. So we had this situation in the so-called advanced economies where the number of workers relative to the dependents went up. That's also deflationary because when you're working, you're typically spending less than you're taking in, right? So that's deflationary. When you're a dependent, when you're retired, you just spend everything you get. So those two forces were constantly putting downward pressure on inflation. And I would add a third thing, which is the emergence of wealth inequality. Again, wealthier people have a lower propensity to spend, right? You know, if an extra dollar to someone who's really wealthy, maybe they buy another boat, maybe they don't, but typically they spend less of it. So all those, well, the first two things are now changing, right? China's already been integrated into the global economy. There's not another big dividend of a massive increase in the global labor force coming. And the same thing is true of the demographics in the advanced economies. It's going to be an aging society. So both those things are inflationary and they're happening, you know, like tectonic plates, they're shifting. And to counter that deflationary force that we've had for the last 30 years, we've had central banks being very expansionary, right? Increasing the supply of money. And we talk about this in the book as a kind of uneasy equilibrium where the downward deflationary forces are being held at bay by central banks. Once in a while, we have a deflationary crash like 2008 or 2020. We call them carry crashes. Other people call them deflationary crashes. So now those deflationary forces are changing and they're starting to push up. And we still have central banks pushing up. And now we've got in the U.S. the most expansionary fiscal policy that we've had in 30 years. So all those structural forces that that central banks were acting against are changing. So I think we've got everything pushing in an inflationary direction right now. That's why I think we will and probably have to experience inflation to get rid of the debt. And I think the structural changes are now causing that to start to happen.
Well, it seems like the carry regime is quite deflationary because it constantly is amassing debt as well. And so if if the spigot is turned down on carry, the amassing of debt will be, theoretically, would slow as well.
Would start
to
slow.
Is that an element of that as well? Or?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yep.
How do you distinguish between, let's say, 4 years, there's another market crash, recession? It's hard to say what is what anymore. Is it a market crash? Is it a recession? We don't even know. How do you distinguish between a future carry crash or a regime shift?
That's a challenging question, and the answer is a little bit technical, but remember, we've talked about carry as being a trade that makes money if nothing happens, right? So if the world stays stable, carry does well. So in the carry regime, as carry trades are expanding and growing, the level of volatility that we see falls, right? So the measure that people often use is the VIX, which is just a fancy way to measure the level of expected volatility in the U.S. stock market. And so what we say in the book is that if we're in a situation where the carry regime is truly ending, then we're going to see the VIX, this measure of volatility, move to sustained higher levels. And we're going to see the price of typically put options are more expensive than call options, so people will pay more for downside protection than they'll pay for upside protection. We would see that reverse, because in an inflationary world, prices would be going up, 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 and up. So people would actually not be so worried about a crash as prices running away from them. So we would see that, that so-called skew in the options market starting to change. And we might also see, well, I'll leave it at that without, I don't want to, kind of dive into.
Go ahead.
So we would say you really need to keep a very close eye on the volatility markets. And, you know, if you're going to ask where we are now, we were sort of wondering this in 2020, is this the end, or is this a, are we reloading? And volatility mm-hmm. now has, the skew is still there. Puts are still more expensive than calls. The VIX has come, it hasn't come all the way back down to levels that that we were used to, but it's not as elevated. So I think we're probably still kind of in the carry regime, but we also say that it's not likely to be a transition that's kind of smooth. It could be discontinuous. Mm-hmm. It'll be tricky to tell, but I'd say that the volatility markets are the place to watch.
Yeah, I remember when March 2020, things were going crazy. I remember looking at different bond indexes. Just all the numbers were wild. And I was like, oh my gosh, like, is this, in a moment of silliness, is like, is this it? Like, is this when the governments can't pay their debts? Mm. And then I was like, no, I bet this is, not that I'm some predictor of anything, but I was just like, no, things last so much longer than you ever could imagine. I bet we get another thing and this goes, we have another recession. Maybe we have a second one after that until these debts, they actually struggle and they really actually then finally need inflation to take care of them. Right. Who knows? It's a very strange world we live in right now. That's all that I know.
Jamie, who's, one of our co-authors, he says, well, this, because I know I think the title of your podcast is about empires and how they change. And, I've heard him say, we may be at kind of similar to the end of the Roman Empire where, things are the foundations that made it great are starting to change. But then he said, that the end of the tail of the Roman Empire was hundreds of years, and people living during that time actually had a pretty good, life.
Yeah.
So, some of the forces that have made the U.S. the dominant economy in the world, obviously that's changing. But like you say, this could go, could be a process that takes decades or longer to fully unwind.
It certainly could. Do you think about, oh man, the next crash or recession that could be what puts us over the edge? Or do you even think in those terms at all?
I do think in those terms. I try to think about, I think to me, what I worry about is just how exposed. So if we're talking about the potential for inflation, that means interest rates could rise. And it seems to me the whole edifice of the markets is all built on low interest rates, right? There's mm-hmm. so many people who've got mortgages that if interest rates went up a couple of percent, they would be unable to pay. And so much of the economy is driven by the housing market that you could have a really big kind of vicious cycle going on there. And I see, so I do worry about how, is there a way for governments to respond if we do get higher inflation, because higher interest rates could tip the economy into a really deep recession. If they're not able to raise interest rates, then you're talking about the potential for very serious inflation, which in itself could be detrimental to markets. So yeah, I do worry about that. And I do look for ways to try to see if I can, benefit from that, that spike in volatility that will come when that mm-hmm. happens. The problem, of course, is, as we talked about, if you always want to be long volatility, then you're losing money for months and years until this event happens. If you try to time volatility by saying, okay, well, I'll just buy protection right before the crash happens, then you're in a world where you're trying to time markets, and that's very difficult to do as well. Yeah. So the way what I end up doing is just advising people to say, you know, if you think about your asset allocation, how much you have in risk assets versus cash, just take into account that there's a possibility that, you know, these sort of crashes that we've seen in 2008 and 2020, not a possibility, we'll definitely experience another one of those without question. So just try to organize yourself so that you can, you know, ride that out. And it might be the case that central banks aren't able to stabilize things as quickly as they have.
Well, you're kind of touching on it just now, but I want to end here with, it's a bit of a more personal question. How do you think about your family and your family's future and your personal financial planning in regards to everything we've talked about?
I try to do exactly what I've just said, which is make sure that I've got, you know, where I can, if I look at a route in the stock market that doesn't immediately bounce back, can I ride that out? So basically my allocation to stocks is pared back maybe from what other people would do. Also in terms of, in terms of debt, I try to avoid investments that are, honestly, levered, but to the extent that I have some investments that are levered, I try to keep them at kind of boxed so that if they go wrong, it doesn't spill over. And I know that's, maybe I'm probably in a different position maybe than some other people. So I do think the stretching to, for mortgages and things like that could be quite dangerous right now, unless you can lock in an interest rate. Like in the U.S., we have these 30-year mortgages. Actually, I think those are really great deals right now because you're basically you're buying some insurance. If you can lock in a very low interest rate right now, that's probably a good thing to do.
Yeah. And I know that you're in your wife's home country. Do you think about stuff like that at all, of with social unrest in the U.S., or is that kind of like, wow?
I have to say that my wife's from New Zealand, and we moved here in January, not permanently, but temporarily, because, we were able to, and they handled the coronavirus much better than the U.S., and
You're keeping the American accent strong. I'm not hearing too many hints of Kiwi just yet, which is good.
Nah, mate, I'm not going to lose my American accent. I don't know. I do think that I'm actually an optimist. I think democracies are being tested right now, but. Mm. Any system that doesn't get tested becomes more and more exposed to change over time, right? It's this kind of evolutionary idea. If the world stays the same and then suddenly a meteor hits and everything's wiped out. So because they haven't developed or evolved to deal with that. So democracies are being tested, they're being pushed, but I actually think that's a good thing. I think the systems, the closed systems like China or Russia, they might appear stronger in the short term because, they're not forced to deal with change. I mean, I'm a different generation than you, but when I grew up, we were all told that the Soviet Union was going to overtake us. It had a bigger economy, a stronger military, and then all of a sudden it collapsed within 18 months because it was a system that was closed. And so... I would encourage people to, not get too depressed about the state of our democracy. It needs to improve, but we're being tested, and I think we're going to come out of it stronger. and we will find solutions, democratic solutions to these problems. So I'm optimistic.
Well, I love that. Yeah, I love that. I think that's your next book right there, that democracy is being tested, closed might look good in the short term.
It's what Kelly Clarkson said, right? What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So
yeah, exactly. Exactly. And then you can get Kelly Clarkson to push it out.
there's my cumulative advantage right there.
Yeah, exactly. We're just making up all these ideas right here. So thank you so much for joining. We've mentioned the book a million times at this point. Where can folks find it, and where can they find some of your work and writings if they want to read more?
The book's called The Rise of Carry, and there's a website actually called www.riseofcarry.com where you can get you can read a free chapter of the book, and you can also buy it. And then on that website, there's links to podcasts that we've done. Hopefully, we'll be able to put up a link to this one at some point, and also articles that we've written. So I think that's probably the starting point. I write occasional articles for Forbes. So if you just Google Forbes, Kevin Coldiron, you see some of our stuff, some of my stuff as well. But yeah, that's probably the best place. www.riseofcarry.com is the best place.
Okay, great. Well, Kevin, thank you so much for joining. It's seriously been a pleasure.
No, it's my pleasure, Bradford. And thanks for asking me. And I wish you all the best with your series. I've looked at some of the other episodes that you've done. They're fascinating. So I'd encourage people to go and take a look at it.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Okay.
All right. Have a great day.
You too.
Listening to other YouTube channels, I hear a lot of the smashing the like button. I'd like to suggest to gently click it. It's gonna be nicer on your computer and probably longevity for your technology anyway. So likely click that subscribe button, like, rate, review. It is the best way to help us reach more audience, more people, and that way we can keep producing content every week. Make sure to drop a comment below who you'd like us to interview next, and we look forward to seeing you next week.